If we want to move forward in any practical way with limits, we'll need to develop some limit laws that allow us to actually get some work done on larger expressions. So here we have 7 of the basic limit laws, and I'll say a little bit about where they come from or where they'll be proven, but we won't prove any of them here in this video. So 1 and 2, sum and difference limit laws. So this just says the sum. First one says the sum as a limit of x goes to a of f of x plus g of x is the sum of the limits. So we have the limit as x goes to a of f of x plus the limit as x goes to a of g of x. Same thing for the difference, just replace the sum with the difference. So those are 2 things we'd really expect limits to have, and we should be very thankful that they have them because they make the limit much nicer to work with than if this wasn't true, if it didn't have this additive property. Same thing with number 3, the constant multiple, which says that if you have the limit as x goes to a of c, which is a constant, times f of x, that's the same as c times the limit as x goes to a of f of x. So essentially the constant comes out of the limit and goes to the front, which we see it here in the front. So 1, 2, and 3 are proven using what we call epsilon-delta proofs. Epsilon-delta proofs. We'll do those in an upcoming section, so we certainly don't need to worry about that for now. Okay, 4 and 5 are the product and quotient limit laws. So number 4 says the limit as x goes to a of the product of f of x times g of x is simply the product of the limits. So limit as x goes to a of f of x times the limit as x goes to a of g of x. And again, a really wonderful property to have, and that's what makes the limit so wonderful and calculus work so well, is that we have this multiplicative property, and then with number 5, we have a property for division with the quotient law here. So the limit as x goes to a of f of x divided by g of x is indeed the quotient of the limits. So we have limit as x goes to a of f of x divided by limit as x goes to a of g of x, with the caveat that the limit of x goes to a of g of x cannot be 0. These 2 are a little harder to prove. You can find proofs of these in the appendix of our book and a lot of calculus books. So I will refer you to that and not prove them here. Number 6 is the power limit law. That just says that the limit as x goes to a of f of x to the n is the same as the quantity of the limit as x goes to a of f of x all raised to the n. So essentially, this limit here comes inside the n power. So now here in the second version, the limit's inside that power to the n. Well, for proving number 6, if we accept number 4, the product rule, the product limit law, then the power limit law follows from that very nicely, because f of x to the power of n is just f of x times f of x times f of x. So if number 4 is true, 6 follows from that. So that's okay. There's a proof. Done. Finally, we have the root limit law, which essentially says that the limit comes inside a 1 over n power. So we have the limit as x goes to a of f of x to the 1 over n equals the quantity, so the quantity of the limit as x goes to a of f of x all to the power of 1 over n. We have provided that f of x is greater than 0 near a if n is even. So that's just to avoid getting into complex numbers, which is a completely different class and a very interesting class. So take a class in complex analysis. You do all this calculus again and more using the complex plane instead of the real numbers. So highly recommend that class. The proof of number 7, the root limit law here, comes from an upcoming section where we're going to talk about the limits of compositions. So notice that this is a composition of f of x is one function and something to the power of 1 over n is another function. So we have a limit law about continuous functions and compositions and how the limit comes inside of a composition of functions. That'll all be upcoming in a future section, so we'll just say continuity for that one. Okay, so now that we've established the limit laws, let's see how they work in an example. Okay, so here's an example. We have the limit as x goes to a of the quantity 3x squared plus 2x plus 7. Okay, so I see a sum of a few different things here. So let's use number 1, the sum limit law, to break this up a little bit. So we'll say by number 1, we then have the limit as x goes to a of 3x squared plus the limit as x goes to a. You can see this gets a little bit cumbersome, and we'll deal with that in a second, of 2x plus the limit as x goes to a of 7. And I guess a fact we should just mention that the limit as x goes to a of some number, we'll just say of a constant, is simply that constant. If there's no variable, no x, nothing happening with x in here, this constant doesn't care at all, it's still the constant. So that tells us that this last term here, limit as x goes to a of 7, is simply 7. Okay, well now we have constants in the other two terms, 3x squared and 2x, so we'll use this constant multiple rule, number 3, to bring those constants out to the front. Okay, so number 3 gives us 3 times the limit as x goes to a of x squared plus 2 times the limit as x goes to a of x plus 7. Now, that's a little weird, but I guess that works. Well, now we have a power in this first expression here. We have x squared. So we can use number 6, the power limit law, to work on that one. So now by number 6, we have 3 times the quantity limit as x goes to a of x all squared plus, okay, 2 times the limit, nothing changes there, as x goes to a of x plus 7. Okay, time for another fact. The limit as x goes to a of x is simply a, right? If we get it all the way down to we're just taking the limit as x goes to a of x, well, that's just a. So back to our expression down here, we have 3, limit as x goes to a is a, but that's squared, plus 2a plus 7. And there we have used the limit laws to evaluate an expression for a polynomial, and note that this is the same as if we would have just plugged in a for x in this polynomial. So we did that once, and I think you'll agree with me, we probably don't want to have to do that ever again. And the good news is that there are theorems, so we don't have to do it again. And here they are. The limits of polynomial and rational functions. So this tells us that if we assume that p and q are polynomials and that a is a constant, then for polynomial functions, we have the limit as x goes to a of p of x is simply p of a, which would have saved us a lot of time on that example we just did. But we did it once, we've kind of built up an intuition that we would expect this to be true, and here's a theorem that tells us it's true. Again, this would be something you'd prove in a later course. I'll just leave you with a theorem here, but from now on, once we have this theorem, we can happily just plug in a to the polynomial and be done with it. Similarly, for rational functions, we have the limit as x goes to a of p of x over q of x is simply p of a over q of a, meaning we just plugged in a and didn't look back. Provided, right, one caveat, that q of a does not equal 0. Okay, so thanks to those, anytime you have a polynomial or a rational function, you simply plug in a and don't look back when you're evaluating a limit. So now that we can work with polynomials and rational functions and powers and roots, there's one last property that will really allow us to get busy evaluating some limits here. This is known in some circles as the simpler function property, and it says if f of x equals g of x when x does not equal a, then the limit as x goes to a of f of x equals the limit as x goes to a of e of x, provided such a limit exists. So what this is a fancy mathematical way of saying cancel first and then try to evaluate the limit. Or I'll say a little more accurately, cancel first and then try the limit again. So here's a subtle and simple but important example of this property in action. We have the limit as x goes to 2 of 4 times the quantity x minus 2 over x minus 2. So if we examine what happens at the point x equals 2, all kinds of chaos breaks out, right? Because if we plug in 2 for x, we get 0 over 0, which is horribly undefined. The point is we can still evaluate this limit because the limit doesn't care what happens at 2 because the limit never gets to 2. So as long as the function is okay everywhere else besides 2, then we just look at that. If that's the case, then we can simply cancel out x minus 2 and x minus 2, giving us the limit as x goes to 2 of 4, which is simply 4. So now that we've built up our limit laws, the real key in evaluating all the limits that are in this section is to use the simpler function property and essentially get things to cancel until you can evaluate the limit. So you plug in first, basically using the limit laws that we've learned. If it doesn't work and you get something undefined, then you cancel things out and try again. That's in a nutshell how you approach these more computational limits in this section.